Let's then turn to the memory approach and the reception of Jesus. This conference is related to the publication of the reception of Jesus in the first three centuries reference work. It's also, however, related to the emergence of the so-called memory approach onto the scene of New Testament studies in general, and Jesus and Gospel scholarship particularly. And to anyone familiar with the emerging approach, if you look at the programme, it is a veritable who's who of the contributors to this field. The programme and the presentations of the speakers are intended to clarify what this approach is and is not about. Now, that's not to say that all of the speakers will agree. Far from that being the case, I'm sure that there'll be a variety of opinions on a number of issues. But there are at least two catalysts for the need to provide some level of clarification and consensus about what memory is all about. The first catalyst is that though most of those who adhere to this approach are convinced they're doing something different from previous models of New Testament scholarship, and that this something different consists of moving on from a particular legacy of form criticism and historical positivism. But, and this is an important but, some critics have stated that memory scholars are not in fact doing anything new. So here's a matter that needs clarification. Is the memory approach actually something different than what's preceded it? If so, how's it different? And what significance does that have? The second catalyst relates to the broader dissemination of the term memory and assumptions about it in New Testament scholarship. When I first started studying social memory theory 13 years ago, I could probably have counted all the New Testament scholars in the world who were actively using it or engaging it on the fingers of two hands. With some more recent publications, it seems that it's broken into the mainstream of New Testament studies. Now, of course, as a proponent, I think this is a good thing, but it's come at a cost. I tried to find a way to say this diplomatically, but it comes to this. It's difficult to avoid the conclusion that many New Testament scholars reacting to this theory have made initial assumptions about what memory is and have worked primarily on that assumption rather than engaging with the critical discourse about memory and memory theory. Put differently, a surprising number of statements about memory theory that have passed through peer review processes are unquestionably inaccurate. For example, in one recent article, no, there isn't a footnote here. In one recent article, the authors described the collective memory theory of Maurice Hobvachs and the cultural memory theory of Jan Assmann as one, synchronic and only concerned with the preservation of the past in the brain, two, not concerned with diachronic transmission of tradition, and three, primarily based upon literate cultures. And Chris's point is that all three of those are mistakes. I can only affirm what my friend, colleague, and sometimes critic Sandra Hubendahl has stated in print, quote, "The good news is that social memory theory has finally found its way into biblical studies. The bad news is that it's often unclear what social memory theory really is about." So in addition to asking, is the memory approach something different, there's also a second, although more fundamental question: what is the social memory approach? Now, this entire conference is designed to provide answers to that question from a variety of experts on a variety of topics. And these experts are well placed to offer these answers, beginning shortly with Christine Yeager. And it should be clear that one purpose of the conference is to clarify what we mean by reception and memory, and that what we mean by those terms is relevant well beyond historical Jesus studies, which might be the area where these things have been most ardently debated. So in anticipation of these talks, I'm offering here a few preliminary remarks on reception, memory, and their usage in New Testament studies so far. What do we mean by reception? The presence of the word reception in our conference title indicates and assumes a certain relationship between reception and memory. In very general terms, a reception history approach is rooted in the principle of Wirkungsgeschichte, which has been translated as effective history, history of effect, history of influence, impact history, or similar terms. The concept originates with hermeneutical philosopher Hans-Georg Gadamer, who was highly interested in the historically conditioned nature of understanding. It emphasizes the impact of prior knowledge, understanding, and tradition upon a given interpreter, and thus sees any given interpretation of a text as a product of a mixture of what the interpreter has inherited from the past and the present circumstance in which he or she receives the past. In practice, this synchronic focus upon the historically situated interpreter has inevitably also led to diachronic approaches that reconstruct the long interpretive history in which any interpreter stands. In other words, further developments of Gadamer's insights have led a number of scholars in multiple disciplines to focus on the afterlife or history of reception of a text or an event. Generally speaking, then, a reception history approach is as interested in the impact of previous interpretations upon a given text or event as it is upon the impact of that text or event upon subsequent interpretations. A reception history approach thus has a wider view of the interpretive task, insisting that the full understanding of an event or text must include its afterlife. Along these lines, this approach includes interest in the ways in which later interpreters exploited hermeneutical possibilities in texts and traditions that may or may not have been part of the author's initial purpose. The originating moment of a text or event is thus viewed less as a standard by which all subsequent interpretations are measured, and more as a catalyst for those subsequent interpretive encounters, providing both hermeneutical possibilities and hermeneutical constraints for later interpreters. So, reception history in New Testament studies. A Wirkungsgeschichte approach has been employed in a variety of interdisciplinary fields, and New Testament studies has been an important part of this conversation. For example, Marcus Bocknell has urged New Testament scholars to adopt, quote, the history of the influence of the New Testament as an integral and indeed inescapable part of the exercise in which they're engaged. Noting further, New Testament studies on this view could find a focus in the study of the New Testament as not just a historical, but also a historic document. To an extent, whether scholars and readers of the New Testament adopt such a perspective is perhaps beside the point. As David Parker notes, from a text critical perspective, they already operate with an intuitive understanding of it. Parker cites as an example the pericope adulteri of John 7:53-8:11, probably not part of the earliest version of John's Gospel, but widely recognised as one of the most popular stories from the Gospels. This is Parker. We may make the decision that it's not part of the canonical Gospels. We may even decide that it's not an account of an incident in the life of Jesus. But however we read the Gospels or think about the historical Jesus, this story will have influenced our views, and we cannot read or think as if we would never have known it. In this sense, as though, although an impact history exists in a complex relationship with an originating event, sometimes directly related, sometimes indirectly related, and sometimes very minimally related, the history of effects is never entirely separable from a given interpreter's conceptualization of that text or event. Put another way, any given interpretation of Jesus is necessarily influenced by the interpretations of him that have preceded and reached the interpreter, and any subsequent interpretations will be influenced by the hermeneutical shape of that interpreter's distinct representation of Jesus. Standing in this stream of research, the reference volume I mentioned earlier will be a first of its kind comprehensive overview of the reception history of Jesus in the first three centuries. It approaches each historical source for Jesus as an instance of reception. Reception, in this sense, refers to the interpreter's critical inheritance of previous interpretations of Jesus, wherein he or she is both indebted to those interpretations and catalyzed by them in offering his or her own image of Jesus. We're therefore here interested primarily in how Jesus was remembered, conceptualized, and interpreted anew in various times and places in early Christianity. Overall, the reception of Jesus in the first three centuries presents a reception history of Jesus in the formative period of early Christianity. So, reception, memory, and the task of the historian. Although this volume will be the first to apply this approach comprehensively to the historical sources of Jesus, it's not the first such application in Jesus studies. Indeed, such an approach has been steadily changing Jesus studies for the past 30 years, in many ways establishing the need for a comprehensive application that this voice means. For example, Gert Tyson and Winter's groundbreaking Die Kriterienfrage in der Jesusforschung, which was translated into English as The Quest for the Plausible Jesus, applied a history of effects to the historical Jesus in 1997, I'm quoting. The historian is interested in determining the material relation of Jesus to his context and to the history of his effects, in which there will be both points in common and points of disagreement, both lines of continuity and discontinuity. The sources are part of his historical effect, even when they cannot be traced back to Jesus in a monocausal manner. In the same year, 1997, Jens Schröter argued for a reception historical approach to the Jesus tradition that moved away from a focus on verifying isolated elements of the Jesus tradition, and thus did not attempt the, quote, historically and methodologically improper separation of the proclamation of Jesus and its reception. Similarly, in 2003, James Dunn argued that scholars should approach the Gospels primarily as the evidence of the impact Jesus made upon his disciples, hence his title, Jesus Remembered. These approaches coincide with similar developments in Jesus studies that take their primary interest from interdisciplinary developments outside biblical studies in social memory theory and theories of history. These studies have brought about a sea change in scholarly understanding of history and the task of the historian, a sea change that is now fully making its way into gospel studies. So let me answer our first question directly. Is this approach to history something different? Yes, it is. Social memory theory stems from Maurice Halifax, who was the first scholar to articulate clearly that the recollection of the past is always inextricably bound to present social realities. Social memory theory studies thus foreground the complex interrelatedness of the past and the present in any act of presenting or representing the past, insisting that memory is not like a file that stores the past in a pristine state, but rather a process of appropriating the past, whereby both the received past and the present place pressure upon individual or group commemorative activity. In a way similar to Gadamer then, social memory studies are interested in how a given interpreter stands in the midst of a reception history, simultaneously influenced by previous conceptions of the past and his or her own present social context. These approaches share in common at least two important distinguishing features, leading towards a new historiography by those applying them in Jesus studies. The first shared feature is the dismissal of the goal of historical positivism. At risk of oversimplification, historical positivism is the notion that historians can obtain an objective view of the actual past, that is, what really happened. Such an objective view, unobstructed by the interpretations of the subjects of history, is the goal of historical positivism. And its means of achieving that goal is to get behind the sources to the history. Gadamer showed this goal as naive and only a simulation of objectivity. Similarly, and building critically upon Halbwachs, Egyptologist and cultural memory theorist Jan Assmann forwarded the theme of nemo-history. He conceptualized this approach specifically as a rejection of the infelicitous opposition between history and myth in historical positivism, rightly pointing out that all history is interpreted history. Quote, history turns into myth as soon as it is remembered, narrated, and used, that is, woven into the fabric of the present. In other words, the goal of historical positivism was unobtainable from the start, because the past must be interpreted to be remembered at all. Assmann thus outlined a new historical program, which was not the objective recovery of the objective past, but the surveying of how the past had been received in subsequent periods, as well as the forces in the present and the past that influence that reception. Assmann defines nemo-history in this regard as, quote, reception theory applied to history. And he observes, unlike history proper, nemo-history is concerned not with the past as such, but only the past as it's remembered. It surveys the storylines of tradition, the webs of intertextuality, the diachronic continuities and discontinuities as reading the past. So as these quotations reveal, the second shared feature of reception studies and social memory studies is a focus upon the sources themselves, and specifically a focus on understanding how and why they came to portray the past in the manner that they did. This second shared feature is directly related to the first shared feature. Instead of attempting to reach behind the sources in an attempt to access an uninterpreted and raw view of the actual past, scholars have turned their attention to the interpretations of the past that emerged from it and the interconnections between those interpretations. So here let me take a stab at the second question I posed. What is the memory approach? In my opinion, what it's really about is the transmission of tradition, both in the sense of how the ancients appropriated that tradition for their purposes, and how modern historians appropriate the tradition for their purposes. But it's primarily about the transmission of tradition. This shift in focus is much more significant than might first appear. Under historical positivist conceptions of the work of the historian, the cultural interpretations of the past are what inhibit clear and obstructive views of ancient reality. They are thus what the historian must overcome in order to do his or her job. In Jesus studies in particular, scholars develop criteria of authenticity in order to sift through the interpretations of the early church, isolated and verifying the traditions, thereby reconstructing a historical Jesus behind the sources. Under the more recent developments in reception history and memory theory, however, the cultural interpretations of the past are not sidelined in historical work, but foregrounded. These interpretations, viewed as remains of the past themselves, are what allow the historian to discuss the past in the first place, whether they are historically accurate or not. Cumulatively, these new approaches have refined the task of the historian. Similar developments have also occurred in theories of history and have made an impact on Jesus' studies, especially again through the work of Schroeter. Perhaps more than anyone else I would place in the memory approach, Schroeter focuses on the role of the interpreter. He insists that any theory about the historical Jesus is not a construction of the actual past behind the sources, but rather an interpretive representation of the past that offers a plausible account of what could have been on the basis of the sources of the past that remain, and historical imagination. In line with these broader hermeneutical approaches to history, we assume that history is not simply the events of the past that we recover and reconstruct from the sources. History is what we can represent of the past in the light of the sources. According to this perspective, the sources become important as evidence for the various ways in which historical figures and events were received in subsequent periods. The history of Jesus is no different than any other figure in this regard. He was received in different ways, leading to different strands of Christianity from the formative period onwards. In this sense, it will be helpful here to recognise both the similarities and dissimilarities between a focus on the reception of Jesus in early Christianity and the traditional emphases of redaction criticism. This section is looking at reception versus redaction. In gospel studies, of course, the classic cases of redactional approaches have been the modifications to Mark's gospel by the authors of Matthew and Luke. Scholars have mined the interpretive tendencies in order to establish the theological viewpoints of the gospel authors. Clearly, this is a version of studying reception history, and no one would disagree with this point, since both approaches highlight how one interpreter has altered the tradition that he or she received from previous interpreters. The primary area of difference between the approach applied in this volume and the established and correct insights of redaction criticism concern whether or not a given gospel author has theologically interpreted his sources, both are agreed about that, but what those insights indicate about the usefulness of the text for the historian. In the history of New Testament scholarship, redaction criticism often led to a closed interest in history. This tendency was no doubt reflected of the historical positivism that undergirded formal criticism from which redaction criticism derived. Since form criticism understood historical material in the Gospels as that which was recovered out of the interpretations of the Gospel authors. In contrast to such assumptions, and although it bears stating explicitly that this volume does not undertake the work of forwarding theories about the historical Jesus, we're convinced that understanding the relationship between various images of Jesus and the reception history of Jesus that they constitute is a critical first step for the historical Jesus scholar. It should also be said that there are scholars in the memory approach who are less convinced that we can take the further step into speculation on the historical Jesus. But I think we would all agree that if it's to be done at all, it must be done on the basis of the interpretations we have, not their elimination. In addition to the primary goal of offering a comprehensive history of the reception of Jesus in the first three centuries, then a secondary goal of this reference work is to serve as something of a prolegomenon for historical Jesus studies. So, final paragraph on what do we mean by Jesus. At the heart of our project is the figure of Jesus of Nazareth, the Galilean prophet executed on a Roman cross sometime around 30 CE. All traditions ultimately stem from the impact of Jesus' life and death, first on those closest to him, and then later on subsequent generations. It's worth emphasising again, however, that this conference is not an attempt to recover the historical Jesus, even if such a thing were possible, nor are we interested here and now in isolating authentic material, or of establishing original forms of sayings or parables. The focus of this work is in the opposite direction, the ways in which traditions about Jesus have been appropriated, adapted, and reportrayed in a variety of early sources. In other words, we're interested less in the contours, the shape of the pebble that fell into the pond. We're more interested in the ripples from that spread out into the pond afterwards. Thank you.